Hi, my name is Raelene Crandall. I'm an assistant professor in the School of Forest, Fisheries, and Geomatic Sciences at the University of Florida in Gainesville, Florida. And today I'm going to be talking to you about how pine savanna plant communities are resilient to fires during different seasons. Historically, the seasonal timing of fire activity should have been closely synchronized with seasonal climatic patterns. Annual wet summers promote rapid fine fuel accumulation, alternating with dry winters that promote seasonal fuel curing. Late in the dry season, cured fuels coincide with rapidly increasing lightning frequencies as the rainy season approaches. Historically, this late dry season, and usually in the late spring here, convergence of dry weather, cured fuels, and high lightning frequencies was when naturally ignited fires occurred most frequently and burned the greatest area. In the southeastern US, that dry season typically lasts between September and May. Fire is an important natural and human-driven process that plays a major role in shaping plant community structure and composition in the southeastern US. During pre-settlement times, pine savannas would have been distributed across the southeastern US, as you see in the map in the upper right-hand corner. Pine savanna environments differ across their range, and that's why you see different colors on this map. They're representing different sorts of environments. The fire regimes in pine savannas have been shown to influence plant species conservation and ecosystem dynamics. And these regimes include frequent low-intensity fires that occurred every 1 to 3 years in the coastal plain and 4 to 12 years in higher elevations and mountains. Pine savanna plant communities exhibit the highest levels of small-scale plant species richness in North America, rivaling high-diversity herbaceous communities in other parts of the world. In fact, these pine savannas are a fundamental component of the North American coastal plain, which is a recognized global biodiversity hotspot. Fire is essential for maintaining such high biodiversity because numerous species are promoted by fire, and fire actually influences community assembly via plant vital rates. This includes such vital rates as reproduction, seed germination, colonization, and survival. Fire season and frequency can promote or disrupt population level processes that influence the persistence of plants in the community. If fires occur repeatedly during the same season, for example, only those populations that can persist or thrive under that fire regime will remain in the community. So population level effects of fire can trickle up to affect community assembly. Historically, the seasonal timing of fire activity should have been closely synchronized with seasonal climatic patterns. Annual wet summers promote rapid fine fuel accumulation, alternating with dry winters that promote seasonal fuel curing. Late in the dry season, cured fuels coincide with rapidly increasing lightning frequencies as the rainy season approaches. Historically, this late dry season usually occurs during the late spring. Convergence of dry weather, cured fuels, and high lightning frequencies was when naturally ignited fires occurred most frequently and burned the greatest area. Today, few land managers are able to burn during this time because as the dry period lengthens, burn bans become more common, and thus fires are lit both during the wet and the dry seasons because of operational constraints that require burning to occur when burning can occur. These human-induced changes in the seasonal timing of fires in dry and wet periods should create a strong abiotic filter that acts on plant populations, affecting plant community composition. And so this is the basic premise of a study on the effects of fire seasonality that was initiated over 40 years ago. It was conducted in the sub-xeric sandhill pine savannas of St. Mark's National Wildlife Refuge in the Panhandle of Florida. When this study was initially set up in 1980, oaks were thinned prior to the first experimental burns. There were 16 plots that were assigned to 8 different burn seasons, and these plots were burned biennially during the season to which they were assigned. These replications were within every 6 weeks. So every 6 weeks, two plots were burned, and they can be combined in different ways for analysis. And in fact, we did that. We looked at the season of the year. So whether it was winter, spring, summer, or autumn, we looked at plant growth. So whether they were burned during the dormant or growing season when there was less biomass accumulation or more biomass accumulation. And we also based our analyses on weather. If the plots were burned during the dry season, the wet season, or the transition between the dry season and the wet season. So we've analyzed these data in numerous different ways, but in all cases, we're analyzed with frequency of occurrence data or frequency of occurrence per plant. So within each of the plots, the 16 total plots, there were 100 subplots that were sampled. And they were sampled for presence, absence of all of the plant species present. So we were then able to calculate the frequency of occurrence per plant by dividing the number of occurrences per species by the number of subplots, which was 100 in each of the larger plots. Plant community composition was sampled in 1986. Then it was sampled again in 2000. And during this time, the seasonal treatments continued biennially. In 2004, the seasonal treatments ended, and then a variable fire regime was applied to these plots in burn units. So some of these plots were then burned at different times of the year and with different frequency, but they were then burned within a burn unit and not as experimental plots. Before we started analyzing these data, we developed this hypothesis, and I'll call it our hypothesis 2000, that pine savanna fire regimes that differ in seasonality will result in divergent community composition. So we predicted that if you burn and you burn consistently during a particular season, that the communities will diverge. And here, for simplicity, I'm showing you plots as circles, dark gray or light gray. So you could imagine us dividing this then into two different seasons, dormant and growing. So we tested this hypothesis and in fact rejected it. We didn't find, no matter how we analyzed these data, whether by season of the year, plant growth, or by weather, that there were any differences in community composition. Given these results, we thought, well, it would be really interesting to resample these plots after they had had a variable fire regime applied to them. So after 2004, they were burned during different seasons and with different frequencies from 2004 to the present. So we, when we sampled in 2020, we hypothesized that if seasonal fire treatments don't cause divergence in these populations, then a variable fire season and fire frequency also would not cause any divergence, and that there would be similar community composition between the plots. Here I show you a graph of species richness on the y-axis and sampling period on the x-axis. For the 1988 and the 2000 samplings, there were still seasonal fire treatments being applied to these plots, but in 2020, there was a variable fire within the units. So the fires varied by both season and frequency. I've colored the points in the plot according to the burn unit, even though prior to 2004 or the 2020 sampling, they were still receiving the seasonal fire treatments. That's because I want you to see some of the differences that have occurred between these burn units. There are no differences in species richness, regardless of burn season or burn unit in 1988 and 2000, but there is an interaction such that the unburned unit in 2020 has lower species richness than the other two burn units. So those plots that haven't been burned since 2004, since the seasonal fire treatments ended, have significantly lower species richness. And you can see that they're circled here. When we look at the frequency of occurrence and examine the community composition, we find the plots are diverging over time. And so what I'm showing you here is a multivariate analysis in two dimensions. Their circles or the ellipses here represent different years. So the lower ellipse is 1988, ellipse that's overlapping sort of everything. The darker gray is 2000, and then 2020 is in black. Although within a sampling period, there's no difference. There are differences within time, and all of the plots are moving in a similar trajectory. So they're all moving up in this NMDS. The two unburned plots are starting to diverge more than the other plots, and likely because they have lower species richness and they've been unburned for a period of time. We looked at the species that changed in frequency between the 2000 sampling and the 2020 sampling, and this is a change in the frequency of occurrence. This is the number of plots from which plants were lost out of a total of 1,600. So for example, Schizocarum scoparium, or little blue stem, was lost from about 200 plots. Now, this is also organized so that the plants that were most infrequent in 2000 are on the left side. Thus, it makes sense that those plants that were the most frequent during 2000 are those that could be lost from the most plots during 2020. There were also some species that benefited from the variable fire regime. They include Vaccinium, two species of Vaccinium, Laetris tenuifolium, and Quercus minima. And once again, they were most common to begin with, and they became even more common. So those on the right side were the common species prior to the last sampling. So what can we learn from these data? First, the community is shifting over time, and it's shifting in a similar trajectory, regardless of fire season and how these plots have been managed since the seasonal fire treatments have ended. Even those two plots that have remained unburned are following a similar trajectory as the other plots. Granted, they do have lower species richness, but their community composition as a whole is still quite similar to the other plots. Well, this is likely because the fire frequency has decreased, and it's decreased in all of the plots, which is likely going to cause a shift in both species richness over time, and then also the community composition. That might explain some of the additional variation that we see between plots, but it certainly doesn't explain the fact that over time, all of the communities are shifting along a similar trajectory. One possibility is that the original treatments, where oaks were cut and then burned, initiated a long-term successional change in these plots. And all we're doing is seeing succession over time after those treatments. Another possibility is that we're seeing some large-scale environmental factors, such as climate, are changing and causing these shifts, these trajectories over time for the community composition. Regardless of what's shifting the community composition, what came out pretty clear in these analyses is that fire frequency is more important than season in driving community shifts over long time periods. We see that those plots that haven't been burned since 2004 have significantly lower species richness, and they're also starting to shift in community composition and account for a lot of the variation that we see in the 2020 resampling. Now, when I say things like this, people often say, but we see such a difference when we burn during the growing season. And burning during the growing season does have a lot of benefits, including increasing the synchrony of flowering, providing pollinator resources, increasing the production of viable seeds for some species, including Aristida berickiana or wiregrass, and also increasing seed availability. Given that, though, fire season by itself doesn't drive changes in plant frequency within a community. That is not to say it might not drive something else like biomass, but that is not something that we sampled during this project. The bottom line here is that as long as you're burning and you're burning frequently, burning during different seasons isn't going to change community composition. Thank you for listening to my talk. And if you have any questions, you're welcome to email me or connect with me on chat during the conference.